What's up, everybody, and welcome back to my channel. It's time for another recap of what went down on this week's episode of Teen Mom 2. Quick heads up, seasons 1 and 2 of Teen Mom 2 are officially on Netflix USA. I'm gonna be doing a live recap of episode 1 with my channel members. If you wanna join the live chat, hop on video, whatever it is, hit the join button down below to sign up for a channel membership, and I will see you later on today. Now, into this episode, Aubrey is going back to regular school, and then Kayla's back with her on and off again friend Bone, who's like a semi-blonde or something like that. She's blonde on like the very, very top, like not even that much. Then on the very bottom, she is a redhead. God bless. Kale announces her new podcast with V. Then Brianna drops Nova off at school, and she complains about the difficulty of dropping Nova off at school, picking her up, taking her to gymnastics, picking her up again, and then like dealing with Stella as well, taking her to daycare, picking her up and down. And then she complains about Devon. And I was like, okay, but what about the Lewis side of things? You know, like you are having to pick up Stella and take her to daycare and everything, and Lewis doesn't come around, period. Not even when he's back from being on the road. And remember, a couple of weeks ago, Devon leaked the real text messages that MTV misrepresented on their episode of the show, where Brianna canceled his plans to take Nova to gymnastics at the last minute. And we see that that might be a little bit of a pattern for her to hold Nova over his head. So I do take her complaints about him with a grain of salt, even though I definitely am the first to tell you that this man is far from perfect. Anyway, she wants Nova to suddenly start sleeping over at Devon's house a couple of days a week. And her mom tries to like talk some reason into her. She's like, no, what if we start with Devon picking her up and dropping her off at school, gymnastics, and all of that stuff, and then moving there gradually? Because remember, Devon lives with a roommate, so you don't want to just throw a baby into that mix. And Brianna gets really snippy with her mom, which I was like, sis, why are you so extreme? Because you already should have learned your lesson about this when it comes to Nova, who's a very sensitive child. When you threw her into Devon's mom's house in the middle of a school week, and she was so shaken up by the disruption in routine that she had to be picked up from school early because she was so emotional, crying all day. Meanwhile, in West Virginia, Leah decides to get trained to carry naloxone to help people around her who may suffer from an opioid overdose. I found it really interesting that she spoke to Jeremy, of all the people in her life, not her mom, not her sister, or whatever, about this, because Jeremy's the one who has on camera voiced his kind of disdain for her talking about this kind of stuff publicly. So I was like, huh, interesting choice, but I digress. Moving along, Jade wants Sean to go outside so she could do her confessional, but he refuses to do that. So she's the one who has to go outside to talk about, you know, his poor communication skills and not helping with the bills, weighing on her at this point, to the point where she doesn't know if she wants to be with him. She's like, I want him to be more driven, but girl, that is just never happening. You know, you might as well just break up with him. She actually openly admits that she is starting to resent him. And then Sean gets to shoot his own confessional from the comfort of the house he doesn't pay for after Jade had to shoot hers outside. And he complains about how his opinion doesn't matter. Sure it does, because you're the one in here shooting your confessional, paying no bills, when your girl had to go and shoot it outside, you know? And then he cries about how he doesn't know how to express his opinion. And I'm like, what does this guy know how to do? And I'm like, what does this guy know how to do? He doesn't know how to work. He doesn't know how to go to school. He doesn't know how to help around the house. He doesn't know how to speak to a child. He doesn't know how to speak to a girlfriend. So what does this guy know how to do? You know, like, it's crazy to me. Down south in South Dakota, I found it fascinating that Chelsea was talking to that Lori Bell chick without a mask for a second. Then I was like, oh yeah, yes, everybody who shoots for this show has to be tested to appear on screen. I kind of felt like some other people might have pointed that out, so I wanted to just mention it really quickly for you guys. Then even further down south in Florida, Brianna and Devon meet up at a parking lot to talk about Devon helping out with Nova a little bit more, like transporting her around. And Devon says that he is able to do it. He lists all the days that he's available. He says, even when I'm working, I'm off in time to at least take her from school to gymnastics. Maybe you'll have to pick her up from gymnastics, but I can help with that. So like, his willingness to help is a lot different than the way that Brianna has been kind of portraying it. And I found that to stick out. Like, he was really eager to help out with this child. And we already know from Brianna recently admitting it on Twitter that he sees Nova like 5 times a freaking week, right? By the way, he seemed a little bit high to me in the parking lot. I don't know if anyone else caught on to that, but there was something a little bit off with him. Anyway, over in Dover, Kale finds out that half of Isaac's online assignments haven't been turned in properly, so like it's missing, as if he hasn't like completed them at all. And she just gets really frustrated. She's like, the schools have so many damn websites. websites, so many things to click. Like, it's so easy to get lost in everything that they are throwing at us. A couple states over, in Indiana, Jade apparently broke up with Sean after filming her confessional on the front porch. And she tells the producers about how Sean's not contributing to the house and she's done forcing herself to be in a relationship that she is not happy in. And the producer asked her, like, oh, what's Sean gonna do for housing? And I didn't like it, because it's like, women already feel overly guilty and responsible for grown-ass men. So it's like, you know, like, what is Sean gonna do for housing? It sounds to me like a Sean problem. I don't know why you're bothering Jade about it. You know what I mean? Like, I don't want her to second guess herself because she feels guilty that this grown-ass man is about to be homeless if she doesn't financially support him. Because at the end of the day, it's not her problem. And I'm glad she said it. She's like, I don't know, but it's not my problem. Like, I'll give him a little bit of time to figure it out, but sorry. Then we are back in West Virginia, you guys, and whew, I'm gonna be really careful about this. You guys already know how I feel about Leah and Addie and the way Leah and Jeremy treat Addie, or, like, you know, raise her. So what did you guys think about this gum situation? Leah and her girls are in her car and Addie puts her gum on her microphone, which is MTV Viacom property, okay? And then she tries to hand it back to the producer. Keep in mind, we're in the middle of a pandemic, you guys. Like, health and stuff is like a really, really big thing right now, okay? So, like, any other time it would have been annoying and just rude, but now with the pandemic stuff, and then the producer asked her kindly to take it off. She's like, why can't he take it off? I would have, if that were my child or my nephew, I would have turned the F around, like, what? What did you just ask? And Leah is just casually there on her phone as this child is telling a grown-ass man whose equipment that she is putting her personal saliva on in the form of gum to take it off himself with his own hands. That made me really uncomfortable, you guys. I'm sorry. This is not an Addie problem, you guys. This is a Leah and Jeremy problem, because she is constantly doing this stuff in their face and they just laugh it off or just ignore it. Like, you know, the producer does get Addie to take the gum off and then Leah just hands her a bag to put it in. First of all, you should not be damaging people's property and people's equipment. Second of all, you should not be getting smart like that with grown ass people. You know, like, if someone asks you kindly to do something, please do it, especially if they're asking you to fix something that you're ruining. Sorry guys, I don't like talking about Addie all that much just because of the stuff that Leah and Jeremy condone. I think I'm gonna, like, keep trying to avoid her as much as possible, because you guys already know how I feel about their dynamics there. Now, I really like the awareness that Leah is raising about naloxone. You know, like, she actually explains what it is, how to administer it to people, and how it can help people. And I feel like a lot of people are like her, where they, like she was, sorry, where they are suffering with addiction in silence and they don't know anything about this sort of thing. So, like, this kind of information can help them, help themselves, you know. And, like, I'm really proud of her for actually, like, talking about it and getting her kind of certification or whatever it is to be able to carry it to help people. And then she and her sister Victoria talk about all the people in their lives who have lost people due to addiction. And, you know, it's great. She is helping to end the stigma, which is something that she really wants to do. Slipping into Sioux Falls again, Chelsea meets up with another clone friend. Guys, why does everyone in Chelsea's life look exactly like her, dress exactly like her, wear the same makeup as her, wear the same heavy extensions as her, wear the same beanie as her? I really, really, really am confused. Everybody is a tether. Even that Lori girl, who is like 20 years older than Chelsea. I don't know what she's doing to the girls in South Dakota, but every time. And they talk like her too. It's like, what is going on, you guys? Anyway, her friend had contracted the virus at some point, but she is doing okay. The girl is pregnant as well and due around the same time as Chelsea, of course. I wonder if Chelsea sent her that video of her and Cole after, like, they did it and got pregnant and was like, girl, it's time for you to do it too. When the girl did it, I don't know, but, like, the people in Chelsea's lives are straight up cloned in it. Ugh. Excuse me on a little bit. Anyway, back in Dover, we watched Kale and V shoot their podcast episode with Joe. I really loved this podcast episode. You guys know that. I recapped it when it came out. They got really raw and vulnerable about how difficult it was for Kale to accept Joe's relationship with V and, like, you know, the turning point for them and everything like that. It was a really good podcast episode, you guys. Now, in Florida again, Brianna asked Nova how she feels about spending some nights at Devon. mom's house. And Nova is not too gung-ho about the idea because she says that Devon and his roommate are always blasting music very loudly when she's around, which is, to me, really weird and rude. It's like, dude, you've got a kid. You've got to, like, set some ground rules in your house for when she is around. That is just not right. Not cool, I should say. And then Nova's also uncomfortable because she grew up exclusively around women. Her mom, her grandma, her auntie, and now her sister. Like, she's only around women and girls. So to suddenly be thrown into a house with just boys 3 days out of the week, as Brianna wants to suddenly do, of course, is going to be a little bit shocking to a very sensitive young girl. Then over in West Virginia, Leah confronts Corey about the way they all handled her past addiction issues. Guys, I don't like the way that Leah is always coming down on Corey about her past addiction, because it was kind of up to her to let them know as she started to feel herself spiraling. You know what I mean? Like, she goes, you know, like, you guys didn't know that it all started because, like, the doctors prescribed me too much of this or this or blah, blah, blah. And it's like, well, they're not psychic, girl. You could have, like, told them, like, you know, I had a botched epidural. Now I'm on heavy painkillers, just so you know. I'm starting to feel like I'm not myself. Like, she could have had that sort of an open dialogue, but she didn't. I think instead she started banging Corey behind Miranda's back, like they started cheating with each other or something like that. And then that just caused the tensions to go really, really high. And you know what I mean? I'm like, yeah, they all could have handled this a lot better, but starting with the person who was dealing with the addiction, kind of letting them know, hey, something's not right in my world, I need help, and maybe things would have gone a little bit better. She just hid it until it was really damaging to the girls. Remember, Corey was hearing from the girls, allegedly, that they were making their own, like, breakfast, like toasters and the toaster thingy. Maybe they were frying some things at, like, 6 years old, 5 years old. So, yeah, of course, he would have been really, really pissed because, you know, when he would ask Leah what's going on, she would deny that anything was happening. So they're not psychic. You didn't tell them about this botched epidural and being prescribed a bunch of pain medication. And then now when they ask you about it, you're denying it and being really defensive. So what did you expect them to do when their children's lives were allegedly in danger? They don't want someone high taking care of his kids. They don't want someone high driving his kids around. Like, I think these were all very reasonable things. Like, and she never comes down on Jeremy as hard as she comes down on Corey about it. And I suspect that it's because she has a crush on Jeremy or she's still sleeping with Jeremy, but it just rubs me the wrong way. Over in Indiana, Jade and her friend go out to talk about Sean starting to become super controlling of Jade ever since she told him that she wanted to break up with him. Apparently, when the friend came over recently, Sean was like, "What? How long is she being here? Who, blah, blah, blah," like asking all these questions that are literally none of his business. He was also apparently manipulating their three-year-old daughter Chloe, telling her, you know, daddy's gonna be leaving, mommy doesn't want daddy around. That stuff is very damaging to a child. Like, Jade should really nip that in that bud ASAP. And then on top of that, apparently Sean was telling Jade that her mom and her grandma don't think she's a good mom, which, you know, is him further abusing her. God, you know, like, it makes me really sad to see that Jade actually did end up getting back together with this guy. And Jade would talk to her mom and grandma about the claims that Sean was making, that they told him she wasn't a good mom, and they were like, no, we never said that. So when she would go back and confront Sean about that, he would be like, what are you talking about? I never told you they said that, to gaslight her and drive her crazy, which to me, it makes me sick to my stomach to imagine anyone going through that kind of psychological torture in a relationship. And it just makes me really sad to see that she did get back together with him after this, because he literally brings nothing to the table, nothing except abuse and an empty wallet, you know? But again, they don't call it the cycle of abuse for no reason. You don't just get out of a relationship and bounce. Typically, like, it takes a while. You just keep going and going and going, breaking up, making up, breaking, until you finally had enough. Now, after the podcast that Jovi and Kale shot together, they talk about the issue with the teachers. Joe's like, you know what? I sat in on one of Isaac's Zoom classes and it only lasted like 12 minutes. What are the kids learning if the teachers just pop on for 12 minutes to tell them about all assignments that they have to do? Like, these kids are not learning anything at this point, and I really feel quite badly for them about that. I feel so bad for all the kids this year. It's a very depressing year for kids, and you know, the long-term effects of it are going to be really interesting to see when the studies come out. Now, in the final scene of the episode, the DeJesus family is at the kitchen dinner table, and Brianna's talking to Nova about spending more time at her dad's house, and Nova reiterates feeling a little bit uncomfortable about, like, you know, being in a boy's house around the roommate and blah, 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 and stuff like that. And, you know, Brianna asks her, like, but, like, you like your dad, right? You like spending time with your dad? And Nova's like, yeah, like, I like spending time with my dad. And that's when little Stella chimes in, you guys, and she goes, I don't like my dad. They go, oh, no, what do you mean? Like, you gotta like your dad. Like, and then Brittany's like, why don't you like her dad? And then Stella's like, I don't like my dad. I like Devon. And then Nova talks about how Devon always plays with the both of them. And my heart just broke for little Stella in that moment because she just, you know, like, she's watching her sister, like, have a father figure, and she doesn't have one as well. Devon is nice enough to include her, like, you know, as if she's his own daughter as well. He even buys her gifts for her birthday, picks her up, like, all that sweet stuff. So I really hope that hearing that and seeing that kind of wakes Brianna up a little bit to say, listen, like, this is who my other daughter sees as a father figure, even though, like, you know, like, we were over long before she was born and stuff, and, like, he's nice enough to come around for her. I really need to stop trying to push him away and instigate things with him, because at the end of the day, like, these two girls love him, right? And they are sisters. And yeah, you guys, that does it. A recap of what went down on this week's episode of Teen Mom 2. As usual, I'm more excited to hear what you have to say about everything. Don't forget, I'm going to be doing a live recap of season 1, episode 1 of Teen Mom 2, a real throwback, live 2 p.m. Eastern Standard Time on my membership channel. Hit the join button to join us down below. And in the meantime, let me know all your thoughts and opinions about this episode in the comment section down below, and we'll chat. That's all for now. Thank you so much for watching, and I'll see you next time.